Hello and welcome back to the GUSEK tutorial for beginners. In this video, you start learning about iterated expressions. So, grab a mug of coffee and let us get started. The purpose of this video is to write the iterated version of a transportation problem. First, I will start presenting the example. Then, I will show how to write the decision variables, the objective function, and the constraints. After that, we are going to conclude with an exercise. Remember that in the previous video we hard-coded a problem on GUSEK? The model you're seeing is the one that we used before. It is going to be our example in this video as well. I will leave the link of how to hard-code a model on GUSEK in the description below. As I mentioned, our goal is to rewrite this model in a compact form. Before we jump to the formulation, I will describe the problem. Imagine that a specific product has two suppliers, A and B. There are three customers, 1, 2, and 3, and there's a path between each supplier and each customer. Each supplier has a maximum capacity. For example, supplier A can ship at most 1,500 products, and supplier B 1,000. Similarly, each customer has a demand. Thus, customer 1 needs at least 1,000 products, 2 needs 250, and 3 demands 1,250 products. Each path has a transportation cost. For example, to deliver a product from supplier A to customer 1, there's a cost of $10 per product. The cost from B to 1 is 22, and so on. We can write the transportation cost in a table, as you can see on your screen. The objective of this problem is to minimize the total transportation cost while satisfying the customer's demands. Now that you are aware of the problem, let's rewrite the decision variables. The problem has six decision variables, xA1, xA2, xA3, xB1, xB2, and xB3. The first step to writing the model is to define the sets. In this case, we are going to have two sets. Let's call capital S the set of suppliers. This set has two elements, suppliers A and B. Set capital C is going to be the set of customers, and the elements in C are 1, 2, and 3. Take a look at the decision variables. Can you see that they are a combination of the elements in set S and the ones in set C? For example, we combined A with 1, 2, and 3 so that we have variables xA1, xA2, and xA3. In operations research, we write xij for I in S and j in C to represent that every element in S is going to be combined with every element in C. In other words, we can define the decision variable xij as the flow of product from supplier I to customer j. Now that we have written the decision variables in the compact form, let's do the same with the objective function. The objective function is to minimize the cost of 10xA1 plus 17xA2 plus 32xA3 plus 22xB1 plus 14xB2 plus 8xB3. As I mentioned, the transportation costs can be represented in a table. Each value in the table is going to be replaced by the letter P with its indexes. For instance, PA1 represents the cost from supplier A to customer 1, which is 10. PA2 is 17, PA3 is 32, and so on. Let's go back to the objective function formulation, as you see on your screen. Note that I can replace the costs like 10, 17, and 32 by PA1, PA2, PA3, and so on. This leads to the equation that you see on your screen. Observe that I am multiplying PA1 by XA1, PA2 by XA2, and PA3 by XA3, and etc. The indexes A1, A2, A3, B1, B2, B3 are the same in the multiplication. So I can write Pij times Xij. In this notation, the letter I represents each element in set S, and letter J represents the customers in set C. Since I am adding each Xij times Pij, I write that the objective function is to minimize the sum of I in set S and J in set C of Xij times Pij. The double sum comes from the fact that I have the combination between elements in set S and elements in set C in a single equation. Before we move to the constraints, let's add this form of the objective function to the compact model. Our next step is to write the constraints in an iterated form. Let's go back to the model. There are three types of constraints: supplier's constraints, demand constraints, and non-negativity constraints. We are going to write each one at a time. First, let's start with the supplier's constraints. These state that each supplier cannot send more products than its capacity. I'm going to call their capacity as cap. If you take a look at our network, supplier A has a capacity of 1,500 and supplier B of 1,000. As you see on your screen, we can create a table and cap index A represents 1,500 and cap index B represents 1,000. Recall that we have two suppliers' constraints. Take a look at the left-hand side of the first constraint, XA1 plus XA2 plus XA3. Notice that the first index is always the letter A. Then, we combine supplier A with each one of the customers, as you see in the yellow squares. We can rewrite this equation as the sum of J in the set of customers C of XAJ, which is less than or equal 1,500. We can also replace 1,500 for cap index A. Let's do the same with the other constraint. The first index is supplier B, and the second index considers each customer. Thus, we can rewrite this equation as the sum of J in the set of customers C of XBJ, which is less than or equal 1,000. Note that we can also replace 1,000 by cap index B. Do you see that these equations are similar except for their supplier? Let's combine these two constraints into one. To do that, we need to replace the indexes A and B for index I. We also need to say that this constraint is valid for each I in the set of suppliers. One quick tip. Do you see the symbol of a reversed letter A? It means for all. This is helpful to indicate the number of constraints you are going to have. In this case, we have I in set S. Since we have two elements in set S, we are going to have two constraints, one when I equals A and another when I equals B. Let's add this compact form to the formulation. Now, let's move to the next set of constraints. If we go back to our network representation, you see that each customer has a demand. For example, customer 1 has a demand of 1,000 products. we can denote the demand by the letter D. If you check the table, D index 1 is 1000, D index 2 is 250, and D index 3 is 1250. Let's write the constraints. We have three constraints because there are three customers. If you check the left-hand side of the first constraint, we have xA1 plus xB1. We have the same customer, which is 1. In addition, we combine customer 1 with each one of the suppliers. Therefore, we can rewrite this constraint as the sum of I in set S of xI1 greater than or equal 1000. But we know that 1000 is the same as D index 1, so let me update this equation. The left-hand side of the second constraint is xA2 plus xB2, which means that we have a combination of customer 2 and suppliers A and B. Similar to what we did in the previous constraint, we can write sum of I in set S of xI2 greater than or equal 250. Again, we know that 250 is the same as D index 2, so I'll just replace it. The last constraint considers the combination between customer 3 and suppliers A and B. Thus, I will rewrite it as a sum of I in set S of xI3 greater than or equal 1250. I will also replace 1250 by D3. Finally, we can combine those three equations into one. Notice that their structure is the same, and what changed is the set of customers. So we can replace the customers with a letter J and state that this constraint is for every J in the set of customers. Let me add this new constraint to the formulation. Let's move to the final set of constraints. We are going to apply the same idea of what we did in the decision variables. So we have that xij is greater than or equal to 0 for every I in set S and J in set C. Note that since we determined the constraint for every I in set S and J in set C, we'll have a total of 6 constraints, because we have the combination between the 2 elements in set S and the 3 elements in set C. Let's add the non-negativity constraint to the model. Notice that this model describes the same things as the one that we hard-coded in the previous video. However, in this new version, we need to have a data set to know the values of the parameters. Remember that the compact notation and the data sets are extremely important for the next video, when I will teach you how to code this new version using GUSEK. Before we conclude this study, let me pose you a challenging question. It's time for our quiz. Consider sets I and J below. Set I has elements 1, 2, 3, and 4, whereas set J has elements 1 and 2. What is the numerical representation of the equation sum of J in set J of xij less than or equal 1 for every I in set I? You have three options, A, B, and C. Which one is correct? I recommend that you pause the video now and try to solve it. I will give you the answer after a couple of seconds. I hope that by now you have figured out the best option. The correct answer is letter B. First, the equation states that there will be one constraint for every I in set I. Since we have 4 elements in set I, we need 4 constraints, one for each element. This equation also states that there is a sum of J in set J. Therefore, for each constraint, I will combine the elements in set J with I. For example, if I equals 1, then I will have x11 and x12. When I equals 3, I will have x31 plus x32. Therefore, the correct answer is B. Did you enjoy learning a bit more about compact notations? If you want to practice more, I have prepared a quiz for you on my website, and I will leave the link in the description below. That's it for today. I will see you at the next tutorial, and stay tuned for more videos about GUSEK.